Welcome to Alpha Session 4. Tonight we want to look at why and how we pray as followers of Jesus. The transition is obvious tonight. We're looking more at what it means to be a follower of Jesus, the practices of one who follows Jesus. And prayer is critically important, and it's the first talk for one very clear and obvious reason. Prayer is at the heart of the Christian faith, because at the heart of the Christian faith is a relationship to God. So prayer is the most important activity of our very lives. And it involves the entire triune God, what we call the Trinity, that God is one God in three separate but equal persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18, as we look at this more clearly. In chapter 2, verse 18, Paul writes this, "For through him," that is Jesus, whom he's just referred to, "we both," referring to Jews and non-Jews, "have access to the Father by one Spirit." So Jews and Gentiles alike have access to the one Father through Jesus the Son by the Holy Spirit. So we pray to the Father. Jesus teaches us that. We'll look at the Lord's Prayer later tonight. Jesus taught us to pray to the Father. But we're also only able to pray through the Son. That is, we only have access to the Father because of what Jesus did. Remember what we talked about the last week and the last 2 weeks, really, is that Jesus died for us because we're sinners. We're rebels. We haven't honored God the way we should have. We haven't loved God and people well. We have no credit with God in heaven. But Jesus has unlimited credit because he always did what the Father asked of him. And when God sees us, he now sees Jesus. He sees the righteousness of his Son if we're followers of Jesus, if we've come to him by faith. Look at it this way. It's as if Jesus has a platinum card and it has unlimited credit on it and it's related to prayer. And he gives it to us and say, "Hey, use my card whenever you want." Well, we don't have any cash. We have no pennies in our pocket. We don't have one nickel because we haven't always honored God. So we have nothing. But Jesus says, "Use my card. Just tell them I sent you." So we have Jesus's credit. So prayer is to the Father, through the Son, by the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit we'll learn about more on the weekend, who gives us the words and helps us to understand how we should pray. So prayer involves the entire Trinity. So why should we pray? As followers of Jesus, why should we pray? You could make the argument that God already knows our thoughts, that he knows what we're going to say before we say them. Why should we even bother to pray? Well, there's some really good reasons to pray. Let me explain them. Number one, because it's the model of Jesus. Jesus prayed. He modeled it for us. He taught us how to pray in the Lord's Prayer, which we'll look at later. And Jesus expected us to pray. In fact, right before he introduces the Lord's Prayer, he says, "And when you pray," and when you pray, Jesus just took it for granted that we would pray. He assumed that those who loved him and followed him would spend time in prayer. So first of all, because Jesus modeled it and expected it. Number two, because prayer changes us. Prayer transforms us from the inside out. Prayer affects our attitude. It affects our behavior. You know, when I pray for someone that I'm really bitter toward, someone who's offended me, I begin to soften my feelings toward that person, and I become more forgiving toward that person. Maybe not overnight, and maybe it takes weeks, and depending on how serious the offense, it may take months or even years. But as I pray, God changes my heart. As I pray for other people, God gives me compassion for them. So prayer actually changes me. A third reason we pray is because as followers of Jesus, we're convinced based on the evidence of Scripture that prayer changes things. That is, Jesus answers prayers. He hears our prayer. He cares about our prayer. And stuff around us changes when we pray. The more I pray, the more coincidences I see. And as a follower of Jesus, I'm convinced that that's God answering my prayer. Now, God doesn't answer every single prayer that we pray, and we need to deal with that and ask that question, does God answer all prayers? Well, if by answer you mean does he say yes or no, then of course he answers all prayers. Sometimes he just says no. He vetoes some prayers. So why would God sometimes not answer prayer the way we prayed it? Well, the most important principle here is this: God cannot be inconsistent with himself. God cannot do anything that's inconsistent with his own nature, for lack of a better term. Look at it this way. You know, a kid finishes a test and he goes out into the hallway and he says, "God, please, please, please make Paris the capital of Turkey." You know, God's not going to answer that prayer. He's just not, because that's inconsistent with who he is. So when we look at scripture, we find there are actually some really good reasons why God doesn't answer prayer. And we can talk about the references for some of these later, but let me just give you a few of the big ones. One, it's clear that God doesn't answer prayer if we cherish sin in our heart. In other words, if we're not right with God, if we've done something we know offends God, if we fail to love God and others well, and we haven't come to Jesus and confessed that and talked about that and been restored to him, if there's something between us and God, God's just not going to answer a prayer. He's not going to deal with us until we deal with him. If there's an elephant in the room, we have to deal with that before we pray about something else. In the same way, if we're plotting or planning to do something rebellious, if you're in the process of planning something you know is going to dishonor Jesus, then again, until you deal with God face to face for who you really are and what's really going on inside of your heart, God's not going to answer some prayer about something unrelated. We have to make sure we're walking with Jesus in a restored relationship. Also, if we have wrong motives, you know, if the reason that I'm praying for something is out of selfish reasons, you know, I just want to win the lottery because I want to be rich, because I want to spend that stuff on me, then God's not going to answer that prayer. God will not honor selfish prayers. So our motives have to be appropriate. And also, we have to make sure that we understand what God's will is. You know, I've prayed for people who are sick to get well, and they've gotten well. I prayed for sick people to get well and watch them die. God doesn't always want what I want, and he reserves the right to veto any prayer we pray when he knows that what he wants for us is better than what we want for us. You know, we don't always know what's best. And so when we pray, we pray with a very limited amount of knowledge, but God has infinite knowledge. And so he doesn't always give us what we want. You know, when my kids were 3 and 4 years old, if they had said, "Hey, Dad, can we play with the steak knives?" I would have said no, not because I'm mad at my kids, but because I love my kids and because I know what's best for my kids. And they have limited knowledge. They don't understand they're going to hurt themselves, that they're not ready for steak knives. So sometimes God tells us no for reasons we may not understand at the moment. And we may not even understand this side of heaven, but God sometimes says no for reasons he understands. You know, Ruth Graham, the deceased late wife of Billy Graham, who also recently died, she once said to an audience, "You know, God hasn't always answered my prayers. If he had, I would have married the wrong man several times." So the truth is, God, in his infinite wisdom, sometimes chooses to say no to us because he knows that something is not in our best interest, either immediately or ultimately. And so he reserves the right to say no. So how do we pray? How, as followers of Jesus, should we pray? Well, there are several models we can use, but we don't have to have a model at all. You know, prayer is really how we converse with God. It's how we talk to him and listen to him. And because it's a conversation, there aren't any rules. There aren't any rules in this relationship, just like there aren't any rules in any other relationship that you and I may have. So we don't have to follow any rules or guidelines at all. But sometimes it helps people to have some kind of structure. So let me share this structure with you. There's one called the ACTS acrostic or acronym, A-C-T-S. The A in that case stands for adoration, meaning just enjoying God and praising him and just spending time enjoying his presence. The C stands for confession. It means to admit the stuff that's standing between you and God, the stuff you haven't dealt with, the stuff that's outstanding, so to speak. And then the T stands for thanksgiving, and that is, after confession, just move into a season of thanking God for what's going on right now in your life that you're appreciative of. And then the S is probably why you prayed in the first place, supplication. It just means asking God stuff. Then you pray about all the stuff that's not going well in your life. You pray about the stuff that's giving you anxiety or heartburn, the stuff you really hope for and you're anxious about, not sure about, the stuff that you're disappointed with, the stuff that you're afraid of. So then you just pray about the stuff you would like God to intercede with. And sometimes God's going to change your heart, and sometimes he's going to change the stuff around you. But prayer is critical because it's about a relationship with Jesus. Now, I've used the ACTS acronym before, but my favorite prayer is the model prayer. Jesus actually taught us how to pray in Matthew chapter 6, and you can turn there with me. And I think this passage is really important because it's Jesus' model for how we pray. When we look at the Lord's Prayer, as it's often called, we think of it as a memorized prayer. And the truth is, a lot of people's prayers are limited to memorized prayers or maybe the prayer of panic. You know, it's like the atheist that was in Loch Ness, and as he's fishing, the Loch Ness monster starts coming toward his boat, and he drops his pole and he falls to his knees and he says, "God, please rescue me." Then a voice from heaven says, "I didn't think you believed in me." And the atheist says, "Well, give me a break, God. 5 minutes ago, I didn't believe in the Loch Ness monster either." You know, the prayer of crisis is one of our prayers that we pray. And the other is the ritual memorized prayer. And some people see the Lord's Prayer as one of those kinds of prayers. But if you look at it carefully, Jesus actually says in verse 9 of Matthew 6, "This then is how you should pray." And then he gives the Lord's Prayer. I think we should call it the disciples' prayer and call Jesus' own prayer in John 17 the Lord's Prayer. In this disciples' prayer, it's a model prayer because it is how we should pray, not what we should pray. So I want you to follow Jesus' model prayer, the disciples' prayer in Matthew 6, as a structure, as an outline for how you and I can talk to God if you want some direction. It says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name," or "may your name be honored." So you just start by addressing God and honoring him for who he is. That's something like adoration. The next, it says, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." I think the second thing to do is, after you spend some time adoring God, is you commit your way to God. You commit your life to God. You let God know that you want what he wants more than you want what you want. That ultimately you want God to be pleased with your life and you want God's directions for your life because you want to bring a smile to his face. So you commit your life, your way, and your direction to God. Next, it says, "Give us today our daily bread." You know, it's okay to ask for stuff. It's okay to ask for what you need. It really is okay. If you run a small business and you're having a hard time getting employees, it's really okay to say, "God, I need some employees." Like, ask God for the stuff that you need. He loves you and he wants to take care of you and he's just waiting for you to ask. So ask for what you need. Next, we pray, "Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors." So spend some time in confession. Spend some time restoring your relationship with God, with making sure everything is taken care of, that there's no outstanding debts and balances. Make sure that you and Jesus are walking together. So spend some time in confession and forgiveness. But as you do that, you also make sure that you forgive others as much as you've been forgiven. So this is the time you also pray for the people that have hurt you and offended you, because you can't have bitterness and ask God to forgive you at the same time. You have to deal with both of those. And then finally, we pray, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." It's okay to ask for protection. It's okay to ask God to give you spiritual protection and to protect you from the evil one, to protect you from falling, protect you from making foolish choices. It's okay to pray for that as well. That is a fantastic model prayer if you'd like some direction as you pray. Finally, I'd like to answer the question, when should we pray? Well, the short answer to that question is all the time. You know, it's like you have a cell phone on that's always on, and it's always on the same number. It's a channel open to God. And you can just stop and pray what are often called popcorn prayers anytime, anywhere, eyes open, driving down the road. You can pray all the time. Let me give you an example. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18, Paul writes these words. He says, "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints." So we're to pray all the time, wherever we are. I mean, please keep your eyes open if you're driving, but pray. Pray anytime, anywhere. Whatever is on your mind, God wants to know. You don't have to wait until you're at home or alone. You don't have to wait until spiritual moments to pray. Pray all the time. Secondly, pray alone. Pray alone. Praying alone should be a natural and regular habit for every follower of Jesus. Jesus taught us to pray alone. He taught us to pray alone regularly. And I would encourage you to make some time every day. I choose to do mine in the morning. But I would encourage you to find time every day to get alone with God and spend time in prayer, nurturing your friendship with Jesus. That is a critical part of any healthy spiritual diet. Prayer should be the first and most important habit of your spiritual life. And finally, I would say learn to pray with others. Praying with others is powerful because it teaches you how to pray. I've learned so much about how to pray simply by praying in small groups with other people and listening to them and learning how to pray for them. So I want to end one more time by saying this. At the heart of the Christian life is a relationship with Jesus. If that's true, then prayer is the single most important activity of our lives.